So the first machine that was built to do this was called the Heath Robinson. It was named after this British cartoonist who drew cartoons of crazy machines to do operations. This one was for peeling potatoes. And the timeline of this is quite interesting. So the first operator mistake, the retransmission with abbreviations, happened in August 1941. That was intercepted. Over the next year, that was enough to learn from the two intercepted messages the structure of the machine, then to understand it well enough to develop this technique, the double delta technique, for finding the correct configuration and to break messages. By December 1942, they decided to build a machine and put the resources necessary to design and build a machine. It was requested to be done by June of 1943. It was actually delivered 3 months early. By April 1943, they had the first machine delivered and operational, and it could process messages about 2,000 characters per second. So it was able to do 7 XOR operations in half a millisecond, running this paper tape through at 20 kilometers per hour. This was not quite fast enough. A lot of the value in decrypting messages, especially in wartime, is being able to decrypt them before what the message is describing actually happened. So they built a faster machine. And the faster machine was called Colossus. This was operational by January 1944. And the big change that made Colossus much faster and more useful than the Heath Robinson machines was that they replaced the configurations, which were previously on a tape, with an electronic key text generator. The logic is doing all the XORs and counting the number that are zero. And then it's printing out those tallies so you can go back and find the right configuration. And the ciphertext is still on a paper tape. This is spinning through about 50 kilometers an hour. This is a pretty impressive sight when it was operating, processing 5,000 characters per second. And what made this arguably the first computer was because of the electronic key text, this logic was a little bit programmable. It didn't do always exactly the same thing. There were ways to program it to do slightly different operations depending on what the analyst thought was the most useful thing to do with that intercepted ciphertext. So this was arguably the first programmable digital electronic computer. It wasn't fully programmable. It wasn't a general purpose computer, but it could be programmed to change its behavior slightly. You can see what this looked like during World War II. There are very few pictures of it. This was a very secretive operation. And the machines were actually all destroyed after the war. A lot of the value in breaking a cipher is to make sure that no one else knows that you've broken it. This is different from academic cryptography, where people like to publicize when they break ciphers. In military cryptography, the whole value of breaking a cipher is that your enemy keeps using it. So you want to keep it very secretive that you've done that. A lot of the work on Colossus was not declassified until the mid-90s. Today, if you visit Bletchley Park, you can see a replica, a rebuilt version of Colossus. This is my picture of it from 2004. It does look very similar to the black and white picture from World War II. Unfortunately, they don't operate it frequently, so you won't get to see the tape spinning through at 50 kilometers an hour and all the crunching going on, unless you're very lucky to go one of the few days a year that they might actually operate it. So these Colossus machines had a huge impact on World War II. By the end of the war, there were 10 of them continuously operating at Bletchley Park, decrypting all the traffic that they could intercept. They decoded over 63 million letters of messages in Axis communications. Among the things they learned from them were the troop locations of the Axis on D-Day. This was very helpful for planning the operation. So why did I tell you this story? Well, first of all, it is an important story in the history of both the world as well as computing. But this isn't meant to be a history class, although I certainly like to have historical excursions when I can. But it's also very relevant to modern cryptanalysis. Modern ciphers are much better than the Lorenz cipher. And the main reason for that is we can use computing power to do the encryption. But the basic ideas are actually quite similar. So the goal of the cipher is to hide all the statistical properties that are inherent in the message. And they're present in the key, at least the generated key. The actual key, we hope, is perfectly random. Finding perfect randomness and getting it in computing is quite challenging. But let's assume we have a perfectly random key. What we learned from the perfect cipher analysis is that the key must be shorter than the message. That means in order for the cipher to work, we need to generate more key bits than we actually have. And so even if the original key, and you can think of that in the case of Colossus as the configuration of the machine that comes from some code book that could be perfectly randomly generated, and shared between the endpoints, that is only the starting configuration. There's some larger key that has to be generated to produce the ciphertext. And so both the key and the message have some statistical properties. The goal of the cipher is to hide all those properties. The goal of the analyst is to find statistical properties in the ciphertext and then to use those to break the key or the message. In the case of Bletchley Park breaking the Lorenz cipher, they found the statistical properties when you looked across channels at subsequent letters. There were some statistical properties that were not hidden by the cipher. And that was because of a mechanical weakness that all the S wheels either all moved or didn't move. And that meant that instead of having the long period with no repetition of 19 million letters that the users of the Lorenz machine thought it had, the allies could break that down and find a pattern that was only 1,271 letters long with much fewer configurations to try to have a good guess if the cipher with many fewer guesses needed. In a modern cipher, we think of that as a mathematical weakness. There's some problem in the mathematics of the cipher that leaves some statistical property that a cryptanalyst could exploit. The other relevance to modern cryptanalysis is it's really lots of hard work to do that. I find it quite amazing what Bletchley Park was able to do with Colossus. It still took 6 months of effort looking at those two messages to figure out the key and interpret the key structure from that. That requires an awful lot of trial and error and a lot of creativity, but also a lot of tedious work. In modern cryptanalysis, we try to do as much of the tedious work as possible by computers, but there's still lots of hard work that goes into breaking a cipher. And motivation certainly helps a lot for that. In the case of Bletchley Park, the fear that your country was under attack is a pretty strong motivation.